In this, we wanted to talk about some basic ideas of research. I'm sure all of us have done research, have guided research. Many of us may have even already guided some research. We also may have trained teachers to do what is called action research. So I just want to kind of ask two questions, and since we have very little time, we'd like you to, Farida will also make some preliminary remarks, but first I will like you to sit down in groups and try to address two questions. When do we do research? When do we do research? When do we need to do research? So, or what is research? You know, in a sense, both combined in. And the second question is, what is a researchable question? So come with a researchable question that you think needs to be researched. And so you should also have some idea of how it will be researched. So not the complete details, but some idea of what would be in your mind a researchable question. Is that all right? I mean, I'm saying that because you already have experience of all this. You've done your MA thesis. You have guided your many of you may have may have done your PhD in education also, written a thesis in PhD also, and there are some PhDs in other subjects as well. So what is research? When do we do research? And an example of a researchable question in education. That's the important thing. You want to ask? Yeah.
We should identify the problem. Suppose, for example, impact of INSTEP program on teacher educator. Here the research question is, I will tell one research question, that whether the INSTEP program had impact upon the or on the teacher educator.
A systematized effort to gain a new knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
सर इसके अलावा हम रिलेटिव लिटरेचर को इकट्ठा करने के लिए कलेक्शन ऑफ रिलेटिव लिटरेचर रिसर्च करते हैं सर थैंक यू
रिगार्डिंग द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन दैट व्हेन वी नीड टू कंडक्ट रिसर्च इन माय अंडरस्टैंडिंग व्हेन वी आर अनेबल टू एक्सप्लेन समथिंग दैट वी ऑब्जर्व relating to our practice, particularly I am relating to it education and teaching learning, or something that contradicts our natural expectation, or these are the two basic things I think that leads to a research question which we subject to investigation. We try to collect some kind of data in any form and try to examine it to find out certain ways of explaining it or to validate it. So that is the origin and the purpose of research that I understand. Thank you, sir.
So we'll work in those seven groups, and you have 40 minutes precisely to come back with these two.
Okay. I just want to talk a little bit because of I teach in a postgraduate department, and the overarching activity in this department is research in my department. There are research institutions in education all over the country which are producing theses every day. Almost like our institution alone, there are in one department we have about 50 dissertations coming out of the two MEDs that we have, MED elementary and a regular MED. This is in Jamia Millia. In Delhi University, there's an MED full-time and an MED part-time. Similarly, about at least 50 to 60 students, now little more, writing dissertations every year. And this is only the MED dissertation. There are, of course, PhDs, there are MPhils, but unfortunately, the experience in education has been that out of those 50 dissertations that come every year, not more than one actually contributes, sometimes, if at all, to research and to new knowledge. Okay? MPhil level, we are training people now, which is a more advanced research degree, not very good research at all. Because of this experience and because I work with research students and I have to work very hard with them, I just wanted to make a few points about education. One of the things, I mean, there are lots of you here from science itself, isn't it? You know, the early research, this whole idea of research as disciplinary research, as a scientific activity, actually came out of the natural sciences and came to the social sciences from there. Most of you probably know this. Generally, when, you know, it's a history of knowledge, the present format of what we call research, what is valid, what is not valid, you'd have research methodology textbooks you look at. Where does all of that come from? The whole process started with the very quite amazing, advances in knowledge at a particular time, what we talk about today, modern scientific knowledge. It's linked to something called the, you know, post-Renaissance, the Enlightenment period in Europe, which is not to say that research wouldn't have happened anywhere else or knowledge was not coming from anywhere else, but for a particular reason, you know, factors of history coming together in a certain way, Europe is where the present ways that we think of as institutionalized research disciplines of knowledge came out of there and came out of universities there. Was actually established in universities from outside, started outside the universities and moved to the universities. Once you have disciplines which are formal, once you have research in this formalized way, you also then look for something where you have actually methodologies which are recognized and validated. So everybody just doesn't go with the question and say, I'll do research in my own way, I'll do. All our disciplines, when your dissertation is evaluated, it is evaluated on what kind of readings you've done, what methodologies you've used, what statistics you've used, how you have derived your results. So after all, we have some norms for all of that, which were established somewhere at some time. I just want to talk a little bit about the change in this whole process of trying to think what is scientific research. The earlier paradigm or the ways of doing research, and for very good reason, if you look at the kinds of advances in physics, in chemistry, in the sciences, in medicine that happened over the last few hundred years, they're actually amazing. We take a lot of it for granted, but these are really, really, I think to me, huge discoveries and huge advances in human knowledge which have changed life in really remarkable ways. Even from the time I was a child, I mean, TV didn't exist in India. It came when I was still in school and it was such a huge new invention. And today you have mobile phones on which everything is happening. It is in your hand, you can watch a film, you can have a video, you can have download YouTube, you can do all of these. A lot of people take all this for granted, but this comes out of a lot of knowledge, accumulation of knowledge over a long time, which is then put into some kind of practice, which is researched, which changes the world in many obvious ways. There are these very obvious ways in which research can be seen, but most of research doesn't actually produce results like this. Most research happens very slowly and very cumulatively. So each little piece of knowledge, every little piece of new, what would be new knowledge that doesn't already exist, what we call knowledge generation, which research is meant to do, adds to what was there before. So the fact that when we think of some people are geniuses and they do great research and others are not is not true, actually. If you look at the great geniuses who have done remarkable research and suddenly come up with something wonderful, is because they are doing it with the help of a whole lot of things that are there. It's just that at a certain time, things seem to fall in place. There's a whole lot of knowledge you might need to find that one extra step makes it extraordinary. it's true that sometimes, you know, there is that extraordinary creativity that comes of having all that in front of you. And it may not be there if you had much less knowledge. So you can see, you know, the advances in research build up on what was there already. You won't find any great mathematician coming out of no mathematical training. You can look, I mean, we talk about geniuses, etc. But you read about those geniuses and you'll see there is, they have had some inputs on which they are building. Similarly, physics, whatever, wherever there have been these great inventions and new knowledge, it comes out of a body of knowledge which already exists. So I just want to go back to the question of, you know, you do research when you observe things and you don't find a solution. In fact, research cannot just be done on the basis of observation and you don't find a solution. You observe, you don't find a solution, you read. You research first what is already there. And that is something very important for all of us to remember, because the kind of research we do in educational settings, we, you know, there are people who have been doing research in many areas. Even all the dissertations I'm talking about, which are lying in universities, very often not published, some of them might have quite important knowledge there, but it's available. So instead of, as soon as you say, okay, I can't find the answer to this, I'm going to do research, you might want to know, let me see what has anyone else done research on this already. Do they have an answer? And very often, a lot of the problems we talk about today in our education system already have some research available, on which we can then build and make something more. So your research questions should build, a question is very, it's very good to get a question out of what you're seeing around you. But don't assume at once that now I will start researching this question. The first thing you assume is, can I discuss with other people? Are there ways that other people have thought of these questions? Are there solutions that people have tried? I mean, there might be solutions, there might be research which is showing things happen, but they may not work in your situation. And then you can say you really have a good site for research, that given that all of this has worked, it can be done, why is it not happening in my classroom? Or why is it not happening in this setting where I am working? Why is it not happening in the school I am, you know, associated with? Is there something about the context of where I am? Is there something about who is involved in this interaction? Where you have, research has to be carefully, research questions should come out of very deep probing and a thorough analysis already of what exists first. Then you'll have a good research question. One of the ways, it's, and there are, you know, good research question requires a lot of thinking and a lot of knowledge. One of the things that people forget, and in education, which is a huge problem, and I want all of you to think of that a little bit, because most of you are actually educators. It's not that you're really fresh students. What we have in education is a huge problem in another way. When we get people, see, most disciplines, I'll talk about Delhi University now, which actually has very good undergraduate courses. If you're studying history, you can join a BA honors course in history. You get 3 years of extensive reading in that course. Huh? Every year you have 3 papers in history. So 3 years, you have 9 papers over 1 year. And now if you have a semester system, you will have 18 papers over 3 years. Then you go into an MA in history. You have 2 years, same, 4 semesters or 4 papers each semester. How many? 16 papers. 16 and 18? 34, one discipline. In education, what do? We come to education. Your first exposure to probably 5 disciplines in education is in that B.Ed. Yeah? You do psychology of education. A lot of you may not come from psychology. You do sociology of education. You do philosophy in education. You do policy and planning. You do educational technology. Now, at best, you would have come from one discipline or another, because education takes everyone. You can be a mathematician, you can have come from mathematics. But mathematics is what? One paper, pedagogy of mathematics, not even a paper. There's no paper in B.Ed. saying mathematics, you know, as a paper. You have pedagogy of mathematics. And then you go on to, let's say, an M.Ed., you'll have one more paper on pedagogy of mathematics. And then what do you have to do? If you're going into research, you don't do research on mathematics and mathematical ideas per se. You do research on the education, mathematics education or understanding of mathematics or something. So compare yourself to someone who has had whatever, 30, 40 papers to one, two papers in whatever, and some help from your mathematics background. So your knowledge base is much more limited at that stage as compared to other people. And I'm going to say something which is not universally accepted. A lot of educationists won't agree with me, but my own stand in education is that education is a field of study, it is not a discipline. Education is a field, an area of study which involves disciplines, but it is still not a discipline that stands on its own. There is not one discipline called education where, you know, which will help you understand everything about education. I don't know where Kamal and Hari stand on this, but we could have that debate here, and I would like to some of you to think of that and think of it as a debate. Does it? Because over years of teaching and trying to understand why do we have such a superficial knowledge in education, and why do most people who come into education not deeply go into one area of study, and you know, I've been trying to understand how to overcome this and what to do, and it's a problem in this field. And I try and tell my students to concentrate on one area, not to try and be an expert on everything. We cannot be. This knowledge has become too specialized, too broad. You know, knowledge is just growing, especially now with publishing, with requirements for publishing. There is so much knowledge in every field, just keeping track of it is a lot. So if you try and become sociologist, psychologist, philosopher, historian, education, economics, you can't be. So if one suggestion from me would be to actually try and, if you try and get your students to specialize in one area, pick an area which becomes more their expertise, and from that vantage point, look at any other area of education. It makes you, it gives you that benefit of having a background to doing research, to looking for new knowledge. The idea of doing a BA, MA, MPhil in a subject and then doing research, it is exactly that. That you come to a PhD or a research degree when you have exhausted knowing what others have done in that field. Because you have arrived at a area, that is the expectation in a good university of a PhD student, is that they have read everything that there is to read in the field. They know all the research that, I mean, I'm not saying every piece of research in the world, but by and large, all the major debates, the major research areas, what is happening, what is the empirical research, what is the theoretical research, what are the theories that support this field. And you come to a stage where you have questions and none of this can answer those questions. When you come to that stage that you've looked, you've explored, you've looked at all the theoretical points of view, and you still have questions which just don't seem to be answerable, that's when you can come up with a good research question. That's what a PhD student is supposed to do. And to, I'm really sorry, I don't mean to belittle the comment that came from here about studying the effect of this course on teachers. That is not a research question. That is a question we do in education. That's an evaluation question. That's a field study you can do of the effect of some course on something. It's not a research question. A research question has to have a good theoretical background where you already have some hypotheses. This we are doing because we already know training courses affect teachers. So we know there has to be an effect. It's because there has been so much research and there is so much experience in training courses that they are expected to have an effect on those they are training. So we are not going to go and say, okay, now we will see does a training course affect it, you know. How it affects those who have received this training course is one thing you might be interested in, but that's an evaluation of the training course. That's not a research question. Okay? A research question has to have certain hypothetical understanding, certain theoretical understanding, a certain understanding of a field on the basis of which you say that given this, this and this, this should be happening. If it is not happening, what is the problem? Or given this, this and this, this should not be happening. If this is happening, what is the problem? Where can I look for these answers? Those are the kinds of questions that are good, you know, that would start you on some kind of good research. How to answer them is not easy. A good research question needs a lot of thinking. If you very quickly find a solution to answering your question, you should be a little suspicious of is that question very good or not. Because you also need then time and effort to think about what would be the best way to answer this question. because also we are in the social sciences, you are dealing with human beings, you are dealing with an area of knowledge which is very complex and very complicated. We have very easy ways, and unfortunately it's my subject, psychology, which has actually really, I think, destroyed research in education, because that has been the model of doing research in education. Psychology has this very, I'm talking of now very mainstream and one kind of psychology which has actually proliferated in the Indian system, is the psychology effect of this on this, this and this. Education, you'll see these dissertations everywhere. Effect of stress, intelligence, levels of something on academic performance, on achievement, on something. You can look through these dissertations 100 times or you'll get very good results. You get lots of statistics, 5 pages of intelligence tests, 100 students with IQs up and down. What are the results? I mean, it doesn't tell you anything new about it. Today, I have students who come and say, I want to see the result of stress on performance. And I just tell them, sit down and think. You'll know what is the result of stress on performance. Go and read and you'll know how usually stress. But what do we require? Because we require this research design in which you have to have 2 variables, you have to have 1 independent variable, they have to relate to each other, and you have to have a set of statistics that, you know, show something, that you've done an analysis of variance, you've done also an ANCOVA, you've also done something else, you've actually done a factor analysis, so that makes it. I'm not putting down statistical analysis at all. There are some wonderful, wonderful studies which we have, or wonderful knowledge that has come out of factor analysis. You know, there's a whole lot of studies on personality, intelligence in the early years, which factor analysis, you know, lets you group things together which you hadn't thought of connecting within the human mind. But there is a certain limit to these kinds of studies in what we call social sciences, where human beings are involved, where social factors are involved. And for precisely that reason, there has been a trend among social sciences to say that we don't want to be the natural sciences. We don't necessarily want to have this one perfect truth which can never be contradicted. Because there is no one perfect truth about human beings. After years and years and years, officially 200 years of psychological research, there may be 1 or 2 statements we can make with 100% certainty, and which we can say that there are no conditions attached, that this will always result in this. Not one statement almost that we can make with that kind of certainty. So what does it tell us? It tells us that we have to have what the social sciences are now looking for, and what education usually in our universities is not accepting even now. We really think that we can do research which will give us these results, which we can then generalize and say. It doesn't actually. It just gives us the semblance of that we have these results which seem very generalizable. What social scientists for many years have been writing about, talking about, wanting to do, one, those of you who are in the sciences will know that scientific research, experimentation being the scientific method, attempts to do what? It attempts to predict, to control. Yeah, that those are essentially, I know, I mean, even that's changed and you can come in for that, but I can't cover everything. Yeah. Okay, so just in 5 more minutes, because just some of this is important for you to remember. And social scientists for many years now have been saying, starting with anthropology, sociology, psychologists are still not willing to say it fully, that we will not arrive at things that can make us predict 100%. We do not know how to control. We don't want to control. But we want to have an explanation and a plausible explanation of why humans behave the way they do. We know that human behavior is much too complicated to be able to be predicted in these ways, that this human being will always do this. If a child is scolded, they will always do this. We know that. We have done hundreds of studies of what an authoritarian upbringing does to children. We still don't know how exactly it will affect every child. That the same authoritarian upbringing makes one child timid and another child totally rebellious. Okay? And all these years of psychology have not yet given us a complete answer. We know that under certain conditions, given this kind of personality type, given this kind of temperament, this is likely to happen. So social scientists are now willing to say we want to arrive at something where we can have a fairly valid explanation of what is happening and a somewhat supported explanation of what is happening. So if you do 10 pieces of research and 9 of them are saying the same, we at least have a probability of thinking that this is likely to happen and we go with that idea. So it's better to generally do research which is not looking at 100% certainty, 100% success, etc., and get answering the question you have, but just that little bit more of this 1 inch more of understanding the human mind, which is, or you know, a classroom or a situation where social beings are involved. You know, nothing in education is asocial, whether it's policy making, whether it is the context of the child, whether it is the home, whether it is the school. You are talking about a social situation, social context, social structures. All of those are very difficult to comprehend and to arrive at this great understanding of the whole area. So the smaller your research question, the more likely you are to have better results. And the more involved you are in your research question, the more likely you are to do a good research area. Okay, do some good research. So it should be something that really passionately involves you. Usually if you pick an area which really you're interested in knowing the answers and not just an area which everyone thinks is important, you will probably find the ways to get there and you know, find the right methodologies, find ways to answer that question more, somewhat with more probability than others. I'm going to stop there. Maybe
just one small thing. You see, there are many aspects to doing research. There are many purposes, and when we do research, we have to keep why we want to do research in our minds, and they may be different from an academic perspective on research. So I'm just saying that because we should not just look at one perspective of doing research. There are many perspectives. The important thing that I think is important is that when you think of a research question, it has to be important. So if you are saying that I want to study the impact of in-step program on teacher educators, then you have to make the research question such that it is something which makes which gives us something to learn. You can't simply say at the end of the day it has positive impact on teacher educators. That's a meaningless research. So what I think Farida is trying to say is that when you think of a research question, make it something which will be valuable after you finish it. So it'll give us something which can help us build something, which can help us think something. And in that, the first step would be, once you formulate something that you are interested in researching, is to find out what has been done about this already. And there are ways of finding that out. I mean, there is, you will have access to libraries, you will have access to all the sources on the net. And then you will also have to find out who are the people who are working in this area, and then you know, talk to them. So all that would form a part of sharpening and clarifying the research question. And I think the important point that she made is that a research question cannot be, how do I solve the problems of a school, or how do I solve the problems of the of Indian education? I mean, that doesn't constitute something that can be actually done in a couple of lifetimes. So you need to therefore start with a research problem which will be something which about which you can say something. So that's it. I said, so we should now break up into groups, and we'll try and come back at 1:45, so that we have 1:45, 1:45, so that we have at least 15 minutes. We have one presentation and a discussion on that. So please let us, because we will also try and send you some more readings on research, which you can, some elementary courses from elementary course on on research, because research is a very, very complex area. And you could do very simple yet meaningful research, or you could do fairly complex, which requires a lot of, as Farida said, education is, the question whether education is a discipline or not is an important one. And people have different opinions on it. So it is like saying, is engineering a discipline? I'm sure if we think about it, we would also probably have a confusion regarding the idea whether so whether medicine is a you can say medicine is discipline or it is not a discipline. So I think there are these areas where we have to intervene in social lives in very important ways. I think the question that Farida has asked is very important, and therefore the methodology of different questions that you ask in education may be different, because the roots of the question may be in a different discipline. So I think that also is something which we need to be aware of, and the question could be lie in somewhere where is in the domain of a greater scientific where a greater kind of scientific kind of research, although science also has changed its paradigm many ways, or a greater kind of social science research. So when you think about a question, we will now break into group, we'll come back, otherwise this will not stop. So you can think about anything, and then you try and see what we'll come back and do this. Okay, so please into groups fast.
And our answer is to find out the workable, reliable, and legitimate possible options for any issue.
And legitimate possible option for any issue. Second, to find out workable, reliable, and legitimate possible options for any issue. Second, to find out impact of certain interventions and to know that it is actually working positively or not. And the third is to know the possible range of options. Now the second question is, what is a researchable question? Sir, we have done.
That's okay. Okay. We'll go to next group. That's okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Group number four.
Can add kare example?
Sir, example from group five.
Okay.
So this is group number 5, and we have what is that's group number 4. What is a researchable question? Number 1, which is not in a form of a statement and which leads to search for a solution, give clear and specific direction.
We want the example of research.
This come. No, first question. No, then.
For an example, we.
Let me just repeat the two questions. What is research? When do we do research?
Okay.
And example of a researchable question.
I think it was like a what is a researchable question? What is a
research question? The example is, for an example, we are going to get a study on the gender discrimination. Is the girls are not giving equal status with the boys in the morning assembly? So this is a very specific question relating to the study. So the research question is very specific.
Okay,
sir.
Number
Thank you, everybody. The first question was like this, that when do we conduct research? To this question, the group thinks like this. When a person becomes aware of and is sensitive to a discrepancy, that is something he observes, he sees, doesn't goes with the observed or proved facts or with certain kind of theory. Or when this sensitive individual fails to explain a phenomena that he is concerned with. This is one way how we conduct research. The other way, particularly with the practitioners, when the practitioner has some kind of problem and looks for a way out, how to resolve that or how to address that issue, in that case also research originates, that we call action research. The other way, third way, very often we develop something and we want to know whether this would work, this should generate the desired result or not. In that case also we go for conducting research, and this we call the developmental research, particularly more known as research and development. So this is another context. Whenever we launch some intervention and we are interested to know how this intervention impacts or creates to what extent this has improved or not improved, in that case also we go for research. So these are the ways or context in which research originates. The second way, the second question, that is, what is a researchable question? We were discussing, besides our group thought, at the last moment I added one or two points that I will also say. The first thing that we look whether the question that has been or is being researched is amenable to investigations. That is, whether...
We just want an example of a researchable question, if you got that. What you thought of an example. You are this will become too long.
Yeah.
So, if you have did you think of an example of a researchable
question? Okay. A math teacher is teaching in a particular way. And I want to know that why this particular teacher or some such other teachers, they teach the way they are. What is the genesis, whether his belief or his understanding about the very nature of mathematics, or it is his previous training? Question is, what makes the teacher teach the way he is teaching? Sir, let me complete the second question.
That was not the question, so that will not be, we don't have time to discuss.
Okay, thank you.
Because we are already over. Anyone else has very clear answer, to this? Yes, please. Whichever, both questions. You can answer both. But not... What is a researchable question? Example of a researchable question.
Yeah, okay. Sir, when do you do research? The answer is, research starts with a felt difficulty. When a problem arises in any field, then we do research. The second point is to answer any question posed in any field. The third is to make improvement in existing situation. And next is for professional development of individuals. And lastly, we do research with intensive knowledge of the field. And the researchable question is, does poor attendance affect in achievement in language learning of class 1 children?
Any other who wants to add?
Thank you.
Come
So the study is the study on the conceptual understanding of teachers teaching in science at elementary level. The question is, do the teachers teaching science at elementary level have alternative conceptions? And the second is, do teachers conceptual knowledge influence the teaching learning process? Do the teachers teaching science at elementary level have alternative conceptions or misconceptions? Then the second question is, do teachers conceptual knowledge, how does teachers conceptual knowledge influence the teaching learning process?
This is group number 7. The first question, why we do research? When we have some issues, the problems, hypothesis, gaps in the body of knowledge, then which has not been explored, we want to build or add on existing of knowledge. That means it should have on some relevance. And the question number 2, the example on peace education. Peace education included in the school curriculum. Then my research question is that what are the activities undertaken in peace education at the school level? How the children participated activities in the activity?
It can't be a research question.
And all this.
Is there any group left or all groups have two?
Hello, friends. Research is done to fill up the gap of the performance between the two performances from one level and the second level, and to gain new knowledge and to build new knowledge and its applicability to the findings of the research to the society and at the broader aspect. And what is research? Research is a quest for knowledge through diligent research or investigation or experimentation aimed at discovery and interpretation of new knowledge. Again, the application of that depends upon the utility of the research. What is researchable, in my opinion? What factors are responsible to make teachers to adopt child-centered education?
सर टीचिंग लर्निंग प्रोसेस इन साइंस एजुकेशन तो हम क्वेश्चन कर सकते हैं अगर टीचर से पूछना है तो विज्ञान मतलब साइंस में आप कौन कौन सी वैज्ञानिक गतिविधियां करवाते हैं या फिर हम ये पूछ सकते हैं कि आपकी शाला में कौन कौन से जनरल आते हैं कृपया उनके नाम बताएं या बच्चों से हम पूछ सकते हैं कि आपने आपकी पुस्तकालय में कौन सी वैज्ञानिक पत्रिका पढ़ी है नाम बताएं
रिसर्च क्वेश्चन आई हैव फ्रेम्ड सम माय ग्रुप हैज फ्रेम्ड सम रिसर्च क्वेश्चंस रिलेटेड टू ड्रॉप आउट प्रॉब्लम इन आवर स्टेट दे आर व्हाट टाइप ऑफ फैमिली दे आर जॉइंट और सिंगल जॉइंट और न्यूक्लियर सेकेंड क्वेश्चन इज व्हाट टाइप ऑफ फैमिली इन रिलेशन टू एजुकेशन आर दे फर्स्ट जनरेशन लर्नर थर्ड वन इज parents economical condition fourth question related to this is gender Second, fifth one is caste. Sixth one is geographical area. And seventh is teacher responsible in relation to remedial teaching, I mean. That's
sir,
also. Thank
one
you.
More question. Sir, my example is, why do the children of government primary schools present less in number after midday meal?
Sir, one more example I want to add. A comparative study for teaching mathematics in our country and USA. The area is from class 6 to 8th.
Selves have reactions to this. See, the first part is very textbook. जो आप लोगों ने पढ़ा है इट सीम्स टोटली लाइक व्हाट अ टेक्सटबुक ऑफ रिसर्च टेल्स यू रिसर्च इज मेंट फॉर दिस 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 एंड सो आई डोंट थिंक दैट्स सो इंटरेस्टिंग एनीवे आई मीन ऑल ऑफ यू हैव सेड मोर और लेस द सेम थिंग्स दैट दिस आई हैवंट अंडरस्टूड टू हैव अ वर्कएबल रिलायबल एंड लेजिटिमेट ऑप्शन फॉर डूइंग व्हाट सो ऑल ऑफ यू हैव समवॉट आई सी इट मच मोर द एम्फेसिस वाज ऑन हाउ टू सॉल्व अ एग्जिस्टिंग प्रॉब्लम I think for in the educational sector to solve a straightforward problem, an everyday problem, there are other steps before you come to research. No, just for example, to say why do which one would I say?
Why do children attendance fall after midday meal?
Yeah, no, there was another more kind of what very procedural one, the morning assembly. You won't need to do a long research project on morning assembly. Are girls treated differentially? You observe two or three assemblies. There's also some way in what is behind your question, no? Somewhere how you frame the question. Okay, anyway, I'm not going to engage with this because I think most of it comes from what you generally know about why research should be done. I don't think it's something you maybe thought out too much in my personal situation, which is the problem I really come across. We had hoped that you'd actually bring your own experience to it and say, okay, this is a problem that's really been nagging us. We have tried different solutions. We have tried looking at it. There seems to be no other way out but doing some kind of systematic research with it, not just, you know, because very often if you're a teacher in a school or if you're supervising a school system, a lot of these questions can be answered just by your daily activities within the school. If you're a teacher especially, very often you know. See, there's a what happens. There are different kinds of research. One is in education especially, there would be a lot of empirical research which can come out of what is happening here. Okay, what is the method a teacher is using for teaching? This will need documentation and not very much more. Okay. So if you want to say what method is this teacher using, you observe that teacher for a few days and see, okay, these are the methods this teacher is using. You get a report of that, you get a good description, you can have a better done or not so well done one. The more difficult and the more interesting question usually is why. Why is a teacher teaching this methodology? Where is it coming from and what is my what is my motivation in asking that question? Is it because I think this methodology is not working? And am I then presupposing that only the methodology of a teacher is going to make children learn their mathematics? Or am I willing to include other things? What a more interesting question to me would be, what makes children, where does the mathematics learning work? And what are all of the factors that one could think of that are related to mathematics learning? And which one can I study? Or maybe methodologies is then one of the questions. You say, okay, let's look at teacher methodologies. If you take a question like a comparative study of American and Indian teaching, to me that would be a very meaningless to study, because America is as big as India is state-wise. You have whatever 47 states or something. Every state has different kinds of systems of teaching. You have many kinds of schools. Would you say there's one kind of, what was the question? Comparison of what kind of teaching? Maths teaching in class 6 to 8. I can show you five different schools and they'll have five different methods of teaching. Now, how are you going to generalize from that to say this is Indian math teaching and this is American math teaching? It's a very contextualized and very special. Also, to look at what the question you're asking, how doable is that, and is there one kind of teaching methodology that you can just say? You could probably get some results, like what would you take as measurement variables then, and what would you call mathematics teaching in America and in India? What would you take as the generalized one kind of mathematics? Within each state you'll have 10 different kinds of, within each school you'll have five teachers where different kinds of math is being taught, or you know, you might have two different ways of teaching, one math teacher is doing wonders and one children can't understand anything he or she says. So this kind of question where your data itself is going to be very difficult, or even your operationalizing your what you're studying will then become a generality which has no meaning. You can do a research study, you'll say, okay, I'll take five indicators here and five indicators there, but what help is that study? And who is it going to help then? If you're not really going to get anything out of it which really explains something to you in some, you know, meaningful way which could then be applied or whatever, I think, to me, a really relevant question, you know, questions are relevant when they're also dealing with really basic problems of what we are going through. Not questions that just come up here and there. And okay, this midday meal actually is an important question. But, you know, I would be curious to know why you think that children drop out of after midday meal, they don't come to class, because there are a whole lot of assumptions that go with a question like that. Who asked that question? Yeah. So why would you say children are? Because I think you already have an answer to it. I don't think you're asking a question because you don't have an answer. Yes.
My assumption is that after midday meal, the childs go to their house and home due to maybe the bad infrastructure facility, due to maybe teaching techniques, the teacher by which they are teaching in class, or due to unawareness of his parents or economical background of his parents. This is my assumptions.
So you have named four different things which are totally quite big questions and which may not necessarily be connected
to
the midday meal.
We have to be specific on one or
two. No, because you have mentioned the midday meal, I would think your question is related to that, because socioeconomic conditions
due
are
to attendance,
not coming
due
to school.
To less attendance problem.
So why don't you just say attendance? Why are you saying attendance after midday meal? What is the significance of the midday meal in this question?
Because they are coming to schools only taking midday meal, and then they go went to their homes after that.
Okay. So then what are the additional then why would you only question, that question is not going with the question of bad infrastructure in school.
Okay.
Because then you would have to look at this question very differently. If you think that children are actually coming to a place where they don't want to come, but the midday meal is bringing them, to me there are very, very hard questions connected to that.
Yes.
These are questions of, do we live in a country where there are children who cannot get a meal? They will come to a place they do not like to eat food and that they don't have that availability.
Yes.
This is a larger socioeconomic question and not just about your school.
Yes.
It's not about teaching methods. It's not about infrastructure. It's about children who actually don't want to be in a place where they are coming, but they are coming because you're providing a meal. This is a large question which in fact should really trouble all of us as Indians.
Yes.
That it's a really disturbing question that we can't get children into schools, but that one incentive is giving them a meal that they can eat, and these meals aren't very good usually. We've just had examples of what happens. And yet, that children are willing to stay in the school till that midday meal is served and then leave. So it's actually bringing up other questions. The question is not just this. The question about doing research, and what I was trying to say is, when you ask a question, you have to really analyze that question. Where is this question coming from? What am I really interested in? To me, it seems like you are actually looking at, our schools are terrible, they're really not doing a job. But so that's a different question also. You can, the midday meal can be one way of answering your question there. That our schools are really not good enough to hold children inside. So now we actually, we can give a midday meal, they'll come, but they'll still go away. So that becomes one kind of indicator of the school not being good enough or something lacking in the school. Yes. But on the other hand, it's also a larger question. I mean, you have to think of, it's not just a question about, so what is the infrastructure that is lacking? Is it, you know, is it just the infrastructure with what, where you think about a classroom and a place to sit, or you know, a room that is covered, or it's warm in winter and cold in summer, or something like that? Is your infrastructure also the learning materials you're giving the child, or is
the
it
ratio
also,
also the ratio, ma'am?
Is it the ratio?
Child in number.
Okay.
In number.
So you're actually mixing up a lot of questions. So your larger question then is, what are the factors that would determine attendance in schools?
Yes.
I would reframe your question,
yeah,
to say, okay, what factors determine attendance? But attendance by itself is an indicator,
no,
of something else.
Yes.
So as an educationist, you should be thinking of really, what is it about our schools that is, what is happening here? And one of the things you said, like, for example, socioeconomic condition.
Yes.
Why is it that children only of the poor and the underprivileged actually don't come to school? Do you know any child who's middle class or upper middle class who doesn't go to school? Have you ever met any child who drops out and is allowed to drop out of school for ordinary reasons, that they just don't want to go to school and then they do nothing? I mean, they just go and start working.
That they help their parents in some box.
It's not just a school problem. It's a socio-economic,
yeah,
it's a political, it's,
yes,
a social problem of our society. What is it about us that a whole class of people is being disprivileged, and what I would be worried about it as a teacher is much more, what do we need to do to actually, one, I mean, and these are larger questions also. Is our country doing, is education the only way that's going to change these things? Is there something wrong with our social systems where there is so much disparity? Why is it? What is the kind of policies we are following? What are our economics? What is the politics happening that is actually keeping the poor poorer and making the rich richer? So these are big questions which you may not be able to answer, but at the smaller level, then you would want to break that question up. The way I would go about it is actually start looking at what do children's lives look like out of school? What are the circumstances under which a child is living? Who is willing to come to a school, have a midday meal, and then go away and not come back? And what is it about the school or the child? And study it in some, I think we really need studies like that from every region to actually put together enough data to show the complexity of the situation.
Yes.
It's not just the teacher or just the child, or very often I can tell you, people keep saying teachers aren't interested in teaching, whatever. I'll tell you a small example that happened today. I went to a school, I'm doing some field work. This is a small school in a crowded part of Delhi. It's in the heart of Delhi. We have had SSA for 10 years, infrastructure, this, that. Children are sitting on a really torn tart patti, sitting on the floor and writing there, whatever. The teacher, I was in the school 1 hour after the school is supposed to have started. No teachers were in the classrooms because, and I asked why, because they said it's raining, children haven't come. Every classroom had at least 10 children. But they said, we have 50 children in the class, only 10 have come. So I said, if 10 have come, does it mean, there are no children? I didn't say this, but okay, so 10 have come. Then I sit with this teacher whose class I was observing. She comes there and she says, I really don't enjoy teaching in the school. I was actually in a better school and I had to move here. I said, why did you move here? Now, I'm just bringing together all the issues that you've discussed here. She said, because I live closer to the school, and my husband said that the children are at home alone. It takes you it takes her probably 10 minutes less coming here than it would take her to the other school, and that then I can be home with the children and I can be back on time. Now this teacher is actually being dictated to by her husband. I said, would the husband come closer to take a job here? She said, no, no, his job is very important. He won't change his job. So he will not change his job. She is being forced to change her job. She is being forced to come here where she's not happy. And then, you see, it's a much larger social. Now, you can blame the teacher at one level that she should have more commitment than that. But if I was her, I would also be resentful that I have just been asked to leave. And a social structure, she probably lives in a structure where actually it's very difficult to stand up to the husband and say, no, I won't do it, you do it. Why don't you come and start coming home and looking after the children? Very often teachers, the female teaching is a highly female profession, partly because of this, because people feel it's a job where girls can go to school, come back home, they can get married happily, look after their children happily. So you develop. So it's a very complicated question of why teachers are not teaching, why they are not motivated, what are the factors around, why are children then not learning, why is there, it's not so simple as saying, oh, teachers are horrible and they don't like to teach and people, I say this very often and I'm always saying it, that the school and learning situation, usually in economics, all of these are involved. And, you know, I keep telling people that reading is very important. Very often people will say, I become a teacher now, I don't need to look at anything. I keep telling them that unless you're aware of what is happening, what decisions are being taken, there are lots of students who come to education and say, no, I don't like reading newspapers. And I tell them, you shouldn't be in this profession, because unless you understand what is going on around you, you will never understand what is happening in your classroom. So I just want to open up the field for you that, to me, an important research question should be thought out very, very thoroughly with all the implications and all of your understandings as well. That if I know this much, you know, for example, that assembly gender thing, it's probably coming out of the fact that all of you know there is, you know, some gender discrimination. So knowing that there is gender discrimination, what else can one find out about it to make it useful, or to make it, if at all, you're thinking of creating more gender equality, in what ways can one look at this and think of it as gender inequality or equality, and how would that help actually to change things a little bit? Because just changing, if you know that there's gender inequality, and if you have some interaction with the school, or you have some responsibility with the school, then you can very easily, there is enough, we know that this happens, we know how these systems can be changed a little bit. So that you can probably do without doing research. You don't need to research the question first. You can make a change in your own setting about gender, you know, the kinds of things that happen in a classroom, the kind of things that happen in the assembly. The larger question is, what is happening outside of the school that makes these things happen in school? That would be the question I would be interested in asking. What is it about me as a principal, about my teachers as teachers, you know, if I were putting the people, what is it about all of us that allows us to let this continue happening? All of us are sensitive to gender, all of us keep talking about gender, and yet all of this keeps happening in our schools. I would ask that question and start asking those, and then how can I break that question into something smaller which can be researched and which can give me enough information to make some difference to someone who looks at that information.
Thank you, Farida. I just want two sentences. One important thing for
sir,
us.
One question abandoned. Sir, yes, please. Sir. One about the peace education. What do you think?
I think it's covered already. If you
go into individual questions,
mm-hmm. What are the activities have been taken for peace education?
See, at
a school level.
I think let's get back to the issue that we raised. Two things are critical. One, if you know the answer to a question, it is not research to find it. You do research to find out something which you don't know. So that's the first thing. And when you find out something which you don't know, you need to know why you want to find it. And three, don't look for, and before you start finding it out, at least find out sufficient depth what is already known from common sense about it. If you can, it's only worth doing research if you go beyond common sense. There is a lot of research that is done which is kind of gathering what is the color of your shirt, what is the color of your hair. That's not research. I mean, that can be data information for something, but that's not research. So first of all, a research has to have a question which is in some sense, see, look at the definitions of research on one side, and look at your, and we should start evaluating our questions and try to see which category do they fit into. If they don't fit into any of these categories, so whatever the definitions may be worth from textbook, even if we've written them down, at least we should be able to examine our own questions and see whether they go into any of the categories or not. If they don't, then we need to re-examine. And I think one of the tasks that we must do before we go to America is to at least be able to, amongst ourselves, through discussions, each of us should be able to create one question that the person is genuinely interested in finding answers to, or finding more about. I mean, I'm not saying finding answers, because answers are perhaps not always found, but at least knowing more about. So the question about some of the questions are so wide, as Farida pointed out, that, you know, it's not something. So again, the question is that when you are doing research, don't think of a research topic which will be impressive. It has to be something that you want to find out. And then it should be, as I said, and as Farida was trying to say, not something which you already know, and or something which can be easily checked by common sense, by few observations. You have to, all that information should be available to you, and then from there you should kind of chisel out the real question that you want to understand. And then we'll see how you do research. And for that, the first step, as Farida said in the morning, is to try and find out what has already been done about it. And so there may be many, many people who have done already many studies on these issues, and you may realize that you don't need to do this study at all. And if you're going to put in the effort to collect the data, analyze it, then at least you should sharpen, modify your research question such that the work you're doing is worth the effort that you're putting in. See, all this action research that we are doing in this country is a waste, because it is not being, nobody knows why it is being done. So I think the NDIATs, SCRTs who do MEDs, also is because of the fact that there is a thesis that has to come at the end of it, and we never invest in our students enough to try and make them be serious and concerned about the question that they are asking. I mean, forget about the further steps about research, which, I mean, the presentations that and the slides we have, we can send it to you. That's not so important. The important is that, do I have any personal relation to the question that I am asking? That, I think, is the first important thing that we must. And I think that's, unless we have that stake, what we are doing is not research. We can call it by any other name, but can't call it research. So I think we should, it should be important to think about it, that research is not done for somebody else. It is done for finding something out for myself, which then I can share with other people and maybe impress them. But the first thing is to try and do something which will be interesting and important for me to find out. Yeah? Okay, I think that's quite a bit of lecture. We can now go for lunch and try to be back at 3 o'clock, because we'll start the wrap-up at that time.
I am so technology unsavvy, okay? All right, illiterate. Okay, will English do? Should I use both languages, Hindi and English? Okay, see, I think in the interest of what you have to do in the 3 months in Arizona, I will try and speak mostly in English with a little bit of Hindi splattered here and there, okay? So that, you know, you are mentally prepared to learn and make others learn in Arizona. first of all, you know, I mean, I'm so overwhelmed. I have not been able to attend the full 2 weeks workshop. I apologize. And I think I'm actually, more than anything else, I'm sad. Because I think I've lost, missed out on a lot of rich discussions, deliberations among all of you with colleagues that are sitting on this side of the podium and many others who've come and gone. So I think it's a loss to me, but given the bureaucratic duties that I have back in my work, I had to miss some of this. So that's a loss to me. Before I start on anything else, that a few thoughts that I wanted to share, I want to thank all of you for braving the rains this morning and coming and attending the reception hosted by the ambassador. It was a personal pleasure for all of us and the ambassador to see you all there in full strength. So thank you so much. Barish se ladke aap log wahan pahunche, to bahut bahut shukriya. Okay, now talking of INSTEP, India Support for Teacher Education Program, I think it's a small effort by MHRD, USAID, and the many, many education experts that have interacted with you in the over the last 2 weeks, all of who, and including you, I include you in this group, wish to see school and teacher education in India prosper. I think people want to see them these things do well. They want to see a positive change in the school education and teacher education system in the country. Now, how each of us grab this little opportunity that has come our way is really up to us. Most of it is up to us. Dr. Divan, Dr. Khan, and others have tried to sort of, I think, put a spark in your minds here in these 2 weeks. But how you carry this forward is really entirely up to you, your states, I think primarily those two entities. You know, there's this recent film called Bhag Milka Bhag. I don't know how many of you have seen it. Have some of you seen it?
Yeah.
Okay. And then there is a several years old film called Lagan. I mean, I think what I draw from both these films is how an individual or a group of individuals come over a lot of adversity and achieve something that they wish to see in their lives or in their environments. So I think my only point in saying that is that many of us face many challenges in the work that we do, but it's not impossible to overcome the challenges that we face. You know, there are a couple of other examples that I'd like to share with you that happened right here in these last 2 weeks, which are different from what our usual attitude is to work or, you know, to life. You will recall Dr. Ara Barsam. He was here just for 3 or 4 days, but I think he left an impression on our minds. It was a huge takeaway for me, and I think I've individually mentioned it to many of you. He took pains to take 55 photographs outside each day. Why? Because he and his colleagues back in Arizona State University would like to know what are the names, what are the faces of students that are going to come to them, or of executives who are going to come to them for this 3-month course. They would like to know it beforehand. I think this concept of the familiarity with students, whoever, it may be in school education, college education, teacher education, wherever, I think this whole concept of wanting to be familiar with your pupils is amazing to me. And I think most of us in India don't make enough effort to know our pupils that well. Unka sukh dukh, unka what background they come from, what's happening in their family. Most of the time we look at it as two different, you know, watertight compartments, school, college, education, and home. I mean, I think we need to somewhere remember that they're one human being. They come with some baggage maybe, so we need to know them. Anyway, I was quite impressed with that whole thing, and I think there's some takeaway for us from that. Another small example that I'd like to mention, which, and I'm please don't think I'm patting USAID on its back. Ye mat sochega khud ko shabashi de rahe hum. Aap mein se 8 logo ke naam kaafi late pahunch paye the. Aap log yahan join bhi kaafi late kar paye the. Main Raipur mein thi, yahan nahi thi. Mere colleagues, hamari office director, hamari secretary Claret, jinhone yahan bahut se invites handover kiye the, they were working all through 15th August. I was working a little bit from Raipur over emails and phones. Hardy here helped us a lot in putting this together, Anamika ji. I was constantly in touch with both of them to provide us some information which they acquired for us in no time. And I'm so happy that today we were able to have all of you attend the ambassador's reception. It's a personal pleasure for all of us. So, you know, if Anu had decided or Claret had decided ki nahin, ya, ye ab kaun is lafde mein padega, ab ye, nahin hote to art to chhod do. But, you know, that was not the attitude. So my point, I think, again, the takeaway is that we should not give up. You know, there will be systemic challenges, there will be other challenges, but let's not give up. That's my thinking. The other thing quickly about this training, and you've been hearing this and talking about this over the last 2 weeks. This training is not about one size fits all. This training is not about learning something in one place and transplanting it in another place, right? From my perspective, this training is about developing perspectives. This training is about getting us all thinking. It's about developing or reinforcing or changing perspectives. It's about opening the world to us. It's about a blue sky exercise, as we call it. Ki, theek hai, dekhte hain. Kuch toh hoga. Bahut badi dunya hai, bahut khula hai, aasman. Toh kuch karte hain. Theek hai. And again, from my perspective, it is, for me, it's about seeing a desirable chaos, as I call it, in the school classrooms, in the teacher education classrooms. Let there be disorder, but that's a desirable disorder. Everybody cannot be thinking in the same fashion. Everybody cannot be acting in the same fashion. You know, if there are 50 pupils in your class, maybe they think in 50 different ways or 45 different ways or whatever. That's perfectly on. No two human beings are the same. So, yeah, so I would like to see desirable chaos or turbulence in school and teacher education classrooms. Now, I think one of the critical requirements for us to be able to learn is to be open. To be open to other views, to be open to change, not be closed, not be convinced that my opinion is the final opinion and that's it. Right? I mean, there are times when we ourselves have a different opinion over a period of time on something. So likewise, I think, you know, your opinion should be as valuable to me and I should be as open to it as I am to my own, right? So I think that is the first sort of given for any learning to take place in any of us. You know, before I close, I would like to certainly thank a lot of people. You know, USAID is just a small partner in all this. It's a small effort from our side. But it's really the thought behind this. One came from MHRD. Dr. Singh and Ms. Singh represent MHRD for us, and they've really worked very hard to bring it to this place. Another person who unfortunately is not among us right now and couldn't be here through these 2 weeks is Professor Janaki Rajan from Jamia Millia Islamia, who, you know, I and she, we sat down together and sort of culled out this whole idea of, you know, how do we make this work? We didn't want it to be a standardized training. We wanted it to be a need-based training. We wanted it to be useful for all of you, for your pupils, for the education system of India at large. I'm not saying it'll be transformed when you come back. I'm just saying we wanted it to be useful. So we made it as flexible as possible in its design. So Janaki, a lot of thanks are due to her. Unfortunately, she's not here right now, but when she comes back, she's certainly going to. And I did email to her today saying, you know, a big thank you to her and that we missed her. I'm grateful to Arizona State University, Institute of International Education, and Intel for partnering in this effort. They, I mean, of course, Arizona is going to bear it on their shoulders, but the other two also have a great role in making a success of this. I'd like to thank Professor Govinda, Ms. Suhasini, Professor Ramakant Agnihotri, Professor Padma Sarangapani, Professor Vimla Ramachandran, Professor Poonam Batra, Professor Kamal Mahendru, Ms. Deepta Bhog, Professor Sadhana Saxena, also Preeti Rajni Pushparaj, and from Vidya Bhavan, Savan Kumari and Huma from Delhi University for all their input into this. It's been tremendously useful. Last, but perhaps the most critical, Dr. Farida Khan and Dr. Hriday Khan Devan for their amazing efforts in planning this workshop, in taking it to where it has come today. I'm sure you benefited a lot from their experience, from their wisdom, from all the deliberations that happened during the workshop. So thank you so much, both of you. And this is on behalf of USAID, not just Madhuranjan. Finally, you know, as I was hearing you talk about the research thing, and you know, what came to mind was our earlier discussions with Dr. Singh. He's the one who has been very particular and has been pushing for this, you know, critical component of a reform proposal in this whole initiative. What he feels is that, you know, the 55 of you and the 55 others who will go later are your states think that you are among the star performers in your states. You are people who have made a difference in your area of work in the past and who are capable of making a difference in your area of work in the future. He looks to you and your states look to you as serious resources for the future, people who can bring serious reform, you know, at least in a small way, if not in a big way. So as I was hearing the discussion, I was of course extremely happy to hear the discussion on the research that you were talking about. But one of the things that I thought was that basically, you know, the reform question or the reform essay or the reform proposal, as Dr. Singh calls it, to my understanding, is, you know, has to be about something that's bothering you in your area of work. So say if I'm a diet lecturer, senior lecturer, junior lecturer, principal, whatever, and if I feel that why is it that teacher trainees teach school students in a very mechanical way, even though we've put in our best in the diets. You know, we've kind of tried to use participatory methods, project methods, we've danced and jumped about, we've made them think, we've encouraged reflective practice, and so on and so forth. Why is it that we are still seeing a very mechanical mode of teaching in the school classroom when they go for their practice teaching? So, you know, if as a diet lecturer, that'll certainly bother me. So my sense is, and I would request Dr. Khan and Dr. Devan to correct me if I'm wrong, my sense is that that's the kind of thing that we are looking at. This is just one small example that I gave you. It's a very small example. But I think what we are looking at is, what is it that bothers you in your area of work? And something that, like I've heard Dr. Khan and Dr. Devan and others say over and over again in the last 2 weeks, that something, it may be something small, but something that you can influence. So something that is in your sphere of influence, where you can proudly say that, yes, you know, whatever I learned, whatever perspective I built over those 3 months, I can now see it in my work, in my diet, in my SCRT, in my whatever institution I work for. So that's it. I really wish you all every luck. Every good wish of USAID is with you, all of us. And seriously, we look to all of you for some success when you come back, right? Thank you so much. Thank you.
Dear friends, we have come to the end of our 15-day program. It was very, very rigorous, and I know that all of you must be a little exhausted and also a little anxious about going back and joining work and also preparing for your visit to the States, which will happen on 28 September, as I believe. Just a couple of things. First, I will extend my heartfelt thanks to the stakeholders who were involved in planning of this project. Not only the 15-day orientation, but also the 3-month training to ASU. And after that, I will just leave the floor open. We want to share some small tidbits, or you can just say some inputs about the visit, the do's and don'ts, if you may call it, which I would expect, or we would hope that everybody will keep in mind when we go to the States. So right at the outset, I would like to thank USAID, because they are the partners with the ministry who are totally responsible for actualizing this project, the implementation, sending all of you, arranging for the resources, because without that, this would in any case not be happening. So we are very, very thankful to USAID. Also to the core team of academicians who are sitting here with you, Professor Khan, Dr. Devan, Dr. Mahindru. They have been there with you through and through, resolving a lot of issues, answering a lot of questions. They have worked very hard on building the timetable, on the schedule for this entire program, and also getting the facilitators, the academicians who came and spoke to us and addressed us. Everybody, friends, please understand, everybody is very, very busy in their own respective schedules and respective fields. This is time that everybody has taken out because of their own interest in the field, because of their own passion for the issue of education. So I really want to thank all of you heartily from the bottom of my heart for assisting me and assisting the ministry in planning this entire orientation schedule. Also, my thanks go out to IIE, Ms. Shruti, Ms. Namrata. They have not come here today, but John is here. They have been helping in the logistical arrangements, and they will be the ones who will be in touch with you for all your visa formalities. They will take you through the entire thing. So I'm very thankful to IIE. Also, heartfelt thanks to ASU and the faculty who visited us. They will be taking care of you there. They're a very, very good, efficient, competent team. They're very warm people, so I really hope that you can just have a very, very good, meaningful 3 months with them in ASU. I'm very thankful to them, though they're not here. And also to Intel for the ICT inputs. And I would like to just brief Dr. Devan and Dr. Khan, that Professor Khan, that the 2-day ICT inputs that were given after that, it was also felt that some people needed additional inputs on the ICT skills, and some people wanted to work extra on the laptop. So so Intel very happily, very graciously agreed to do it. And you'll be surprised to know, I just got a mail from Saloni in the morning. Yesterday morning, they had a session from 6 to 8. So 6 to 8, and then they had a second session from 6 to 8 again after our regular session, which happened on 15th August. So I think we really need to commend them and their facilitators as well for putting in so much time, and that too at the last minute, to ensure that everybody is on the same platform before they go for the training. I would also like to thank the academic facilitators who very graciously consented to come and be a part of this program, who have been with the academicians, who have been with the team throughout, arranging for your reading materials, passing on whatever knowledge they have to. Rajni, Preeti, Pushpraj has left, and Huma, and also Savan Kumari, she's there. Yeah. So thanks a lot to all of you. You guys just came and really helped us a lot in this entire program. So hearty thanks to all of you. And last but not the least, I also want to thank my own team from the ministry. They are standing outside. They have been waiting with you. They have been helping you. They have been sacrificing all their chuttis. And you know, for Sarkari people, chuttis are like really important. So they have come at all times. They have been available on the phone. They have Xeroxed your stuff at the last minute, sometimes at 7:30 in the night. They have arranged for everything. It would not have been possible if even one of them was not there with us in arranging this entire exercise. So hearty thanks to them as well. So now part two. Part two is just a couple of things which I thought I would share with you, and I would request Dr. Devan and Professor Khan and Dr. Mahindru and also Ms. Ranjan to add on to these issues which I just which I just felt that, you know, I would just share with you, that these are the things which we should keep in mind, because we are visiting a new country for, I don't know for how many of you, but for many of you it would be probably the first time when you're visiting states. First of all, just a brief update is that there have been some reports coming in from the hospital. There are 17 people who have been identified, and John has come with the details. There are some small tests that have to be done, and which, because there is paucity of time and we don't want to hold you back now, I think all of you must have made your travel arrangements to travel back. So my request would be that please go and get those tests done from your respective places, your places where you're going back to, from your districts, any of the hospitals, and do send in your reports back to John by Monday evening latest. That is the deadline that has been given. It's nothing very technical, but it's just a procedural thing that has to be done by these people. So he has the list of names. I think he has communicated some. He's waiting outside. So once this session is over, you can please get the details, and whichever test you have to get done, do get it done and do send it back by Monday. I will not be talking about the classroom situation academically, how you're supposed to conduct yourself, because I think Professor Khan and Dr. Divan will talk about that. Just a couple of things. I think the culture of US is very different from India, and we need to have a respect for that. We need to keep that in mind as a group when we go there. Sometimes there are things, you know, what happens is that sometimes when we go to a very new place or a foreign country, we unfortunately become reckless. We feel that we are protected by anonymity. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Ki hame kaun sa yahan pe dobara aana hai, hame kaun sa yahan pe koi dekh raha hai, hame jaise karna hai hum kar sakte hain. And sometimes events do happen which as a group, then, you know, if an individual or two individuals or somebody decides to be very adventurous, or it could be something as small as people go to a store and think ki are chalo, you know, maza aayega, aise karte hain, ye utha lein, wo utha lein, because their systems are very, very, very strict. Even for a small thing like smoking in India, even though smoking is banned in public places, sometimes we see people doing it here and there. But there, even in your own apartments, I don't know what the setup is going to be. It's a private space. But please do check and find out the details, because they have very elaborate alarm systems. So sometimes you just light up and the whole alarm bell of the entire campus or the entire building goes. And then you will find, you know, ambulances and everything coming to your doorstep. And it will create so much of chaos. And then they'll try to find out ki ye kaise hua. I'm saying inadvertently, I'm not saying deliberately, but inadvertently it might happen. So even smoking in a public place, smoking in a building, whether it is allowed, not allowed, let's just find out, and then we should do something like that. Another thing is IIE will also be talking to you when you leave. Before you leave, they will be telling you all this. Everybody has to do their own work in the US. So I think that is something which we have to prepare ourselves, not so much the women, because I think there'll be a lot of cooking and these kind of things which you'll have to do on your own, fixing your meals. So the men, probably you have 1 month, just brush up your cooking talent. When you go back, just tell your wives to get out of the kitchen and kind of start working, because seriously, this will become an issue, because all of you were there at the ambassador's reception today, the wonderful program that we attended. After that, I was myself pretty shocked, because the ambassador comes with her umbrella, she leaves. There is this sense of doing things on your own. That is the culture. There is a lot of respect for your own individual space. It's not like us, that, you know, we go, and sometimes there have been incidents, not this training, but what we have heard when people come back, that people go, they talk in a certain way to the receptionist or to the person who's driving your vehicle. You know how we are used to as Indians, are ye, are wo, you know, expecting people to come to you. This is not going to happen there. This is not going to happen there. Please take care of it, because you have to respect everybody's space. These things sometimes can become, we might think that these are very small issues, but sometimes even the smallest issues can become into very, very complicated situations which create a problem for us as individuals and also for us as a group. Because as I was telling you just yesterday when I'd met you for the Intel session, please don't forget ever that when you go to the US, you are representing your country. People will not probably remember your names, people will not probably remember even your states or your respective districts, but people will remember that there was this group, X group, which came, where there were 60 people, they came from India. This is something which ASU is going to remember. This is something which everybody you interact with there is going to remember. So please remember that, whether you are in the classroom situation, whether you are outside in a public area, no spitting, no littering, no relieving yourself in the public. So please, these are all very, 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 very normal issues which we think ki are yahan to chalta hai, but wahan pe bilkul bhi nahi chalega. So this is just to avoid any sort of embarrassment to come your way. I'm sure all of you know people who are there or have some contact with somebody who studies there or works there. But please also do check the websites, or also check Google what to expect, what not to expect. Another very important issue which I want to raise is the gender issue, in the sense that women there are differently dressed. Women there have very, very liberated, very, very different attitudes. We have a certain way of looking at these things. I don't want to go too much into detail, but we have to go with very, very open minds, with very, very sensitive outlook on these issues. Because again, you see, they don't take anything lightly. So if we have even one single small embarrassment, it will be a huge colossal problem for you personally, professionally, for the team, for the group. All the good work that has been done can be just brought down. It will come down like a pack of cards. So these are things which I would just request that if you people just have it somewhere at the back of your mind, I think it will really help the program. It will really help you. It'll take this program forward. Because friends, also let us not forget that this is not the first batch. This is not the first and only batch. This is the first batch, sorry, but this is not the only batch. There are more people, there are more teacher educators like you, there are more excited people in the field. They all want to partake of this opportunity. Please correct me if I'm wrong. There are so many people who are now looking forward to benefiting from this program. So we have to take it as a very long-term association. And this is my expectation from the group. And I think you are a family now. I think all of you have enriched from this 15 days of program. I personally have, in coordinating it, in arranging it, in listening to the sessions, in listening to the speakers, in interacting with so many wonderful stakeholders who have just come together to make this program a big thumping success. So I'm really thankful to everybody once again, and I wish you all the luck, very good luck for this program. Thank you.
'll just say a few things, because I've been a student in the US, and I also, knowing students here, our culture is very different. So I just want to warn you. One, that one of the things that's very different about the US culture is you won't have an authoritarian relationship. I mean, nobody's going to come and say you have to do this and you have to do that. The teachers will treat you as colleagues. You see each other as colleagues, whoever, whether they're the biggest shots or, but they expect you to respect that relationship. It's a reciprocal relationship. They will talk to you as equals, and you have to respectfully treat them as equals who you respect in, you know, for whatever they're doing there. But the thing is not then to feel that, okay, because this person is treating me as an equal, I don't have to listen to what they say, which is what we think. No, if someone tells you something has to be done, it doesn't matter, it's not so serious. They don't make a big, huge point of, no, teacher's going to tell you, this is a reading for tomorrow, you must do it, I will punish you if you don't, nothing like that. But you cannot come to that classroom back again if you haven't done your reading, which happens here a lot. You can tell students to do something, they'll just come and say, oh, I couldn't do it. It's just not acceptable there. It's really taken as a serious lack of responsibility. So any work you're given, if you feel there is going to be a problem, discuss it there and then. Ask questions, clarifications. Is it too much, or do you think there might be a problem with it, and is there any way you can be helped? But don't say yes and go back the next day saying, oh, I didn't get time, I couldn't read it. There's no such thing. There are no excuses there for any academic work. You're expected to do it, and unless you're in hospital with a serious illness, nobody is going to excuse you. Okay? Nor are you expected to not arrive in classrooms. There is no such thing as minimum attendance and maximum attendance. There is no attendance there, but the idea is that if you are there, you are there as a serious student, and you yourself will make sure that you are there in every class or every meeting or anywhere that you are expected to be. The other thing is the way of talking to each other. There's a very respectful, you must have seen Dr. Ara when he was here. They're very polite but very firm. There's a different way. It's not to say that they're polite and therefore they feel it's all very informal. It's formal, it's polite, it's very equal, but it's very serious. So when you are talking as well, and this I'll say something because this I tend to do myself and a lot of us do, you just sort of talk loudly or without waiting for another person to finish. In an academic US setting, there's a lot of respect for who's speaking. You let the person speak fully and then you say what you want to say. Or, you know, you wait, you listen carefully. And that you must learn even in the classrooms. When you're having discussion. There will be a lot of discussion expected of you. So you don't have to sit and listen a lot. They'll expect you to participate a lot. So go well prepared, go with questions. And I would encourage you to ask questions because they expect it. It's expected that, you know, in any interaction, in a seminar, in a classroom, there will be a lot of discussion, and the person who's in charge or who's leading the seminar isn't the only person who's expected to talk or come prepared. Everybody is expected to come prepared for it, and therefore everybody discusses. So participate as much as you can. And the other thing I would warn you against, because this is actually something, again, we look down upon a lot, but over there it's not seen as, and it shouldn't be in academic settings. We don't accept the fact, you know, very often if you say, I don't know something, it's seen as something terrible. And I think it's perfectly all right not to know everything and not to be expected to be up to date with everything. If you don't know something, if it's an area you haven't read enough or you haven't been exposed to enough, don't be afraid to say no, because you know you won't learn if you keep trying to maintain an image of where you already know it. If there's anything that's being said to you which you don't have a background to, which you don't feel comfortable, ask for reading. Say, I'm not familiar with this area. You are talking about this. Can you give us some help or give us some background information or whatever? Do that and you will get a lot of support from that system once you do that. But if you sit there pretending you know everything, you'll end up learning nothing, because they, you know, expect you to be honest in an academic relationship, that you'll say what you have to say, you'll say it with some conviction. And especially at the postgraduate level and this kind of level, you know, your mid-level career people who have a lot of experience, they'll expect you to contribute to discussions, to bring your own experiences, to learn from their experiences. And I think having 3 months in a very different setting at one level, which we also romanticize a lot, that American education system is so wonderful, they have everything going for them. You'll realize there, when you're there, they have a lot of problems as well. It's not everything isn't working beautifully. There are lots of dissatisfied teachers. There are huge battles going on between the administration and the teachers' unions. Try and look up some of that material. There's a lot of teachers' unions in the US, and right now they're having very hard pitched battles because they're trying to change the system. There's a lot of this reform that comes from the top and is not accepted sometimes, other kinds of things. There are other kinds of polarities there. Here we have a very obvious rich and poor divide. There are very obvious black and white divide. There are other populations which have problems. They might be of a smaller intensity in some senses and not such large numbers of totally disenfranchised people as we have, but they have their own problems, and try and understand that and see how do they deal with it, what is happening there. Educationally, academically, look at some of the materials there and ask questions about it and try and relate it back to our own situation so that you can benefit from what you do. You know, learning something out of context doesn't become very meaningful. It should actually, you should try and see how does this apply to what we do or what we see. You talk to some of the teachers there, you'll see exactly the same kinds of problems. They'll be saying similar things about students. The students will tell you similar things, you know, that you hear in schools here. So you'll find a lot of commonalities, but take your work seriously. Use your libraries. You know, they have very good systems. And one of the things that I should again encourage you to do, because a lot of our students feel that reticence, and similarly a lot of people who are already supposed to be, you know, have worked, experienced, should have read, is this, you know, embarrassment at going into a library and not knowing how to use it. Nobody there will lift an eyelid if you go to the librarian and say, I just don't know how to look for this book. Tell me how to go. Where is the catalog? What do I do with it? I can't get the catalog working. Ask someone for help. They have enough people in their libraries who are there to do that. They have a lot of students, in fact, who get extra, who get jobs working in libraries, who help other people with this, how, where to find a book, how to find it, which section is where, how do I, simple things which you feel that, how can I not know this? They'll think I'm really foolish. But a lot of us in a new situation, there are things you don't know. I have students who come to Germany and won't go to the library, then they'll tell me 6 months later, but I'm embarrassed because I don't know how to look for a journal. So I now give them lectures in the first week and take them sometimes, or ask the librarian to come and give them an orientation of the library, Sure. I mean, you shouldn't be coming to do an MPhil and a PhD never having looked at a journal. But we have students all the time coming who have never seen a journal and don't know where the journal section is. So you might need some of this information. Ask for it. They're very easy. They help you very easily. And there are enough people usually in any, whether it's a laboratory you might be taken to, whether it's the library, any of the academic facilities. And similarly, the apartments you'll be living in, you know, they'll probably have, sometimes there are things which you are not totally sure of how to work or whatever. Ask someone instead of just breaking something or setting fire to the place. I would advise just go and find out. Because, you know, every day there are new machines and one is wondering what to do. I often get into a new car and I can't open my door because every car now has a new system. You press this button and that button and you're stuck. So the best thing is just ask for information. And why I'm saying this, in Europe it's a little different, but in America they don't mind at all. People are very informal. They're very open to helping you and quite friendly. So reciprocate and, you know, make friends, and it would be nice. It's nice that you help each other and ask each other also. You know, sometimes you may not need to ask someone outside. Just take help from each other sometimes. You know, have you figured out how this is working or not? And make friends with the locals. I think that's one of the nice things of being in a new country, in a new culture. It's really getting to know them. So don't try not to be only with each other all the time. No? So interact with them. You know, be curious about the culture. I think one of the pleasures of life, for me at least, is really meeting new people and going to new places and visiting new countries. And I think they have a good program lined up for you. No? He was talking that day about they're going to take you for visits, etc. Ask questions as much as you can and try and learn as much about the country, the place, the state, as well as the people, and more, you know, problems of education, which is in the more academic setting. But even outside of that, I think even bringing that back to your setting is of help. I mean, it's always nicer, no, to know the world a little more than a little less. Because, you know, as it is in India, we are very parochial and don't like the next state, leave alone the next community, you know. So if you open up, the more communities and the more people you meet, the more you realize the world is one place and shouldn't be fighting about, you know, territories and boundaries and religion and caste every day. So this might be a nice way to also experience that. I can't think of anything else. I think, you know, they'll be there to help you. I think the university system itself will orient you. They're much more, in fact, sometimes one gets a bit irritated because in India we don't spell out everything, but there they really, from the simplest to the most difficult thing, they'll tell you, this is how it's done, this is how it's done. Sometimes you feel it's a bit too much. Do they think I'm that foolish that I can't do anything? But they don't take it for granted that you can, so don't get irritated. Sometimes they think they need to help with everything. So they'll probably give you most things. But what I'm, only thing I'm trying to stress is ask if you think you haven't got something. And it's very acceptable there to ask for help, to ask for something to be done, or how do I do it? Any, don't feel hesitant and then take a much longer time learning it.
Two things I forgot to mention earlier is that the ministry will be in touch with ASU. So please don't think that we will not be getting feedback about what the... Just don't think that, you know, 29 September and now we are in Arizona and picnic begins. That's not how it's going to be. And this is something, this is a suggestion which came from ASU itself, and they said that we would be very keen and we would be very happy to share with you what the group is doing. So one way in which we will formally be in touch with is when you write your concept notes after a month and send them back to us online, and we get it evaluated from our core team and then send it back to you. That would be a formal way. But apart from that, also ASU will be giving us feedback about the group, and we don't want situations where they say anything unpleasant or any absenteeism without any reason, or anybody who is bunking classes or is involved in something like that day Dr. Barsam said that you can't leave, just scoot off anywhere without informing them. So all these due procedures and formalities will have to be followed, and they will be writing to us, they will be writing to the ministry about what is going on, how the group is behaving. So please just avoid anything which lands the group in any kind of embarrassment. We will be getting a feedback, and you have to attend the classes, you have to attend them. There is no getting away from it. Thank you.
So, you know, the big sister will be watching you from there also. No, I just want to say one thing, that I think it has been very, very, very nice for all of you have to spend these 12 days, and I think you all worked very hard. Yeah. So I think that's very important, and I see the passion and the excitement, and I hope you keep this on for the 3 months that you're there. The second thing I want to say is that, you know, while you learn academic things, you learn to read, you learn to all that, there's one very important thing that you will learn, which is to look at a different culture. And I think that's a very important part of education. What are the strengths of that culture? What are the weaknesses of that culture? See, in India, we have a lot of issue of adjustment. No? You know, we say we are a culture which says we adjust, we fix, we adjust. But in America, it is far more like formal, in terms of you once you agree to something, then there is no adjustment. So you listen to what people are telling you very carefully, because you are expected to do that. It is not as if you listen to somebody here, like your students listen to you, and then you know they go and do what they want to. But there, when they give you instructions, they are expecting you to follow them. And if you have a problem, you have a difficulty, please point it out at that point of, I can't do so much. I think that's very important. Because once they've completed your, for example, we've given you so many tasks, and many of you may not have understood the task. But none of you stop to ask, task not clear. So I'm saying that, you know, here, when you come back and say that, you know, like many, I heard in many groups, people asking each other, is that the question we are supposed to answer? That's not the question we are supposed to answer. Why are you saying this? It is not related to the question at all. So I think it is very important for all of us to recognize this fact, that there, the academic atmosphere is very different. The entire culture is very different. You walk into a taxi, you have to treat the taxi driver as if he's a professor. You can't treat him the way we do in India. And that's what, and you know, it would be useful for you to, you know, normally if you use some, so to give an additional amount of 2%, 3%, 10% over and above the bill. I mean, that's considered to be normal routine practice, 10% above the, so you can't go into a shop and start saying, okay, $5, no, I will only pay you $4. So I mean, I'm just saying these are very trivial things, but the half the fun of marketing in India is to haggle. So that fun is gone. So whenever you go shopping, please remember that joy you have to leave behind here. There is some other joy you can get shopping there, but not that joy. And so, and I think it is very, it'll be the other thing which was also said by Anamika. It would be a great opportunity for all the men who don't know how to cook to learn to cook, to cut vegetables, to wash clothes. I mean, I think it's also very important, because eventually when you want to make a difference to education, these are very important, because it helps us understand so much more about the students who are across us, who come with responsibilities which include all this. So doing all this and finding the time to go through all the readings, I don't think you will have time for any mischief, as Anamika is repeatedly pointing out. You will be. I mean, I'm sure you will also enjoy it the way you enjoyed here, working with each other, learning from each other. Because it's. I mean, I don't think it's a opportunity that all of you would perhaps remember after you come back, that you know you learned so much in that effort. And I really feel that, you know, the excitement and the joy that all of you are carrying would see you through 3 months and maybe more if they agree to keep you for longer. Best of luck, and Thank you for being here for 12 days.